big game for both these teams. West Virginia won the toss. They will receive. Drew Gaelitz will kick off for Baylor. Marcus Sims is back deep, and we are underway here in Morgantown. Marcus Sims will take a knee in the end zone as we welcome the Mountaineers to the field, and we find out what we should watch for, Mr. Papadakis.
Well, let's talk about my guy, David Sills, one of the most smart and calculated wide receivers in the country. Great at the goal line, Mr. Touchdown, but he's great all over the field. Has a great rapport with Will Greer. The best defensive player that Baylor has is James Lynch. That was the very first home visit that Coach Rule had when he got the Baylor job, and this guy's all over the field, just a down-home country strong dude.
On first down, there is the first pass of the game. It is to Sills, and Sills gets outside. He's going to be out about a yard shy. That first down marker picks up 9.
And this is what Greer is so good at. He saw Blake Lynch come in on that pressure outside. Just simple. Let me get the ball in my hands, get it to my athlete on the edge, and let him get yards upfield.
33 catches now in the season for Sills. Quick pass this time to Sims, and Sims nearly slips the tackle as he is down at the 47-yard line.
Well, we met with Sims and all the receiving corps yesterday, and that is a guy that can really turn it on and get downfield in a hurry.
Yeah, he leads the team in receiving yards. He's a kick returner, punt returner. This is an athletic guy, very versatile, but we saw him put that foot in the ground on the last play. He gets upfield fast and in a hurry.
He got 13 yards on that one. In motion is Jennings. Greer, with some time, has Jennings wide open, down the sideline. There goes Gary Jennings. How about the start for West Virginia? 53 yards.
A lot of frustration being alleviated with that drive for the Mountaineers.
You'll see Baylor all night. They're going to sub in about 25 guys on the defensive side. Sometimes it causes a lot of confusion. They bring blitz from the secondary linebacker position, and sometimes you're not on the same page, so you have to be aware. And that was just a wide-open play. That's a bad start for the Baylor Bears defense.
Evan Staley on for the extra point. This receiving corps all around is the best group that Dana Holgorsen has had here at West Virginia. On that first drive, Will Greer got each of those receivers in on the action. The first play was to Sills, the second to Sims. The 53-yard touchdown was to Gary Jennings. And it's 7-0 West Virginia here in Morgantown. In their last game, West Virginia had 152 total yards. On that drive, in 3 plays, they had 75 yards in 50 seconds. It'll be Evan Staley to kick off. Trevor White and Chris Platt are back deep for the Bears. And this will go into the end zone for a touchback as we look back at that touchdown where Gary Jennings was so open.
Take a look at Christian Morgan and Blake Lynch. These two are not on the same page. It's supposed to be a man defense, but Christian, he tries a signal when Jennings comes in motion. Blake doesn't get the signal on different pages. You can't have a guy wide open. And Greer, a star quarterback, he's going to find that guy wide open. You can't have those miscommunications in the secondary early on.
To a 53-yard touchdown pass to Gary Jennings. His 7th touchdown catch of the year here on first down. It's Brewer. He's going to tuck it, and Brewer is going to get 2 yards on first down. Kenny Bigelow with the stop. Kenny Bigelow, the transfer out of USC.
Kenny Bigelow was getting excited before the game, yelling at everybody on the Baylor sideline. Even Matt Rule's son.
Nobody's safe. Jamichael Hasty in the backfield here for the Bears. On second down and 8. The pass over the middle. It's popped free. And they're going to say it's an incomplete pass. Denzel Mims was the receiver. Kenny Robinson delivered the blow.
Kenny Robinson, free safety. He comes up and bring the wood here. Right here, he just has his eyes on the ball. Head hits the ball right there. Helmet on the ball, and that's hard to catch. So you got to give Kenny Robinson great job there. And it's a legal hit. That's more importantly. When you have a guy like that running wide open, you want to make sure it's a legal hit, and he does. Gets the ball out. Great job by Kenny Robinson there.
Brings up third and eight. Watch for pressure here from West Virginia. They're bringing it. They pick it up down the sideline, going for Mims. Incomplete. No flag is thrown. Josh Norwood was there on the coverage against Denzel Mims.
And the reason the ball came out was good protection. Jermichael Hasty with a good pickup, but this guy is covered. That is a ball that cannot be thrown there by Charlie Brewer. And this is a very fast and active West Virginia secondary. You see Coach Rule there does not like the three and out, does not like the way this game has started at all in Appalachia.
Drew Galitz on to punt. Marcus Sims is back to receive for the Mountaineers. One of the best punters in college. A fair catch is signaled and made by Sims at the 30-yard line. A 43-yard punt by Galitz. So a quick strike by the Mountaineers. A three and out forced by their defense gives Will Greer another opportunity when we come back. Seven nothing West Virginia leading Baylor here early in the first quarter. Already their second possession. Will Greer, the starting quarterback, he has put up some big numbers already. His completion percentage now at 71.8%. He's 6 yards shy of 2,000 on the year. On first down, the handoff is to Kennedy McCoy. There's a flag, a couple of flags, as McCoy gets down the sideline. But this one could be coming back.
Yeah, that's going to be holding on the starting center, Matt Jones. I saw he just hooked this defender. You can't hold him there.
Holding. Offense, number 79. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. Replay first down.
This Mountaineer team does not have the same fury and anger between the guards and the center as they did a couple years ago in the Dana Holgorsen era. They are more of a passing team, kind of like the Geno Smith model with Tavon Austin and Stedman Bailey. And absolutely right, DeMarco, that's James Lynch being horse-collared there by Jones.
And that negates a 25-yard run. Now on first and 20, trying to set up the screen, and he comes back to Gary Jennings. And how about that throw right there by Will Greer? Saw his first option was covered up and came back to another one.
Well, we talked about how smart he is and what he can see. He's very calm in the pocket. That's what you get with a veteran quarterback. And I tell you, we met Gary Jennings yesterday. What a presence that kid has.
Yeah, unbelievable guy. You can tell he comes from a great family, and he just has a great head on his shoulder. He's all ball. He's a professional young man that he loves the game of football. I love it.
Big and strong.
Second down and nine. Looks like he's hobbling just a bit on the sideline is Gary Jennings. Greer getting pressured, puts it up down the sideline. His receiver, T.J. Simmons, wasn't looking for it as Greer took a hit.
I think it's
Ira Lewis came in and delivered the blow.
Yeah, Ira Lewis, this is something that Phil Snow, the defensive coordinator of Baylor, needs to do all game is get pressure. And if they can get pressure with their four down, they're going to have a lot more success against Will Greer. But Phil really likes to bring pressure from everywhere. They almost brought the corner on that last run play.
So now a third and nine here for West Virginia. And a timeout is going to be called by Baylor.
Timeout. Baylor. First timeout of the half.
So a third and nine, a chance for Baylor to try to get this Mountaineer offense off the field when we come back. Virginia. Out of the timeout, what does Baylor have dialed up? Greer with a fake clap a couple times. Now Greer over the middle, completes that pass to his tight end, Giovanni Haskins. A 12-yard completion, converts it on third and nine. Last week, they were 1-for-10 on third down.
This is what Greer does so well. He understands the defense. He knows where he wants to go with the ball. He looks away to get that linebacker out, and he finds Haskins right over the ball. That's an unbelievable job and effort right there by Greer, putting the ball where he wants it.
I think Phil Snow is going to regret not bringing pressure on that third and long. Baylor can't get off the field.
Hand off to McCoy. McCoy with a good cut up to the 47, picks up four. Jordan Williams with a tackle. There is the defensive coordinator, Phil Snow.
Yeah, has played six corners this year, still mixing it up. Things are a lot better than they were last year for the Baylor Bears, obviously. Phil Snow, known as a guy who loves to bring pressure in a lot of places, knows a lot of fight songs.
Yeah, I mean, he's going to bring pressure from everywhere, secondary, linebacker position. He wants to cloud this confusion for Will Grier, but he has to be careful. He has to get the play calls in. They have to do a better job at disguising because he's so smart at the point of attack.
On second down and six, Grier gives it again to McCoy. And McCoy will get a yard as he gets tackled at the foot by Clay Johnston.
Well, we've seen some pretty good West Virginia backs in the Dana Holgorsen era. I think about Wendell Smallwood. Kennedy McCoy, not as big, only about 195 pounds out of Lexington, Kentucky. Does a good job catching the ball, and that helps when you have a QB like Grier.
Third down and four. Grier again surveying. Flag is thrown, and Grier, he's going to get taken down. Greg Roberts able to step up and bring him down, but let's see if this is going to be the free play for West Virginia, which would lead to a first down if it's encroachment.
Offside. Defense. Number 52. Lined up in the neutral zone. 5-yard penalty. First down.
Our referee is Eddie Shelton.
Grier does such a great job with his pre-snap reads. He'll do the fake clap, the fake double clap, sometimes the fake three count claps because he knows where he wants to go with the ball. He's trying to see what this defense will do, and that time he just gets Roberts on the edge there. You have to watch the ball when you're down in two-point stands.
On first down, Grier down the sideline, and he overthrows his receiver who got knocked to the ground. And that's going to be a pass interference.
Things are getting pretty chippy out there.
Kennedy McCoy was the receiver. Jordan Williams is the one who knocked him down. Then Jordan Williams got a lecture by his defensive coordinator. Was that a catchable ball?
I don't believe it was, but there was such a blatant hit there that the flag came out anyway, and now the refs are discussing it. Certainly wasn't a hold.
Pass interference. Defense. Number 38. Spot foul. Automatic first down.
That's two very costly penalties here on this drive for the Baylor Bears defense. There's no way he was going to get to that ball, but it was such a big hit right there at the stick that the flag came out either way.
Letty Brown, the true freshman tailback, in for the first time here on first down. And Brown tries to cut it up the middle. And he runs into James Lockhart. Second down and 10 coming up.
Lockhart, the transfer from Texas A&M. Both of these teams have had a lot of transfers. Nice play there.
Trying to slow this offense of West Virginia down.
Here comes the blitz on the outside from Lynch here.
Grier goes away from the blitz, and that pass is caught by T.J. Simmons.
Grier's so good at changing his routes. He saw the blitz coming from the boundary, and he's just man-to-man. He knows he has man-to-man outside, so it just hits a hitch on the outside.
On third and three, the handoff to Brown, and that play gets blown up by Clay Johnston. Big-time play by Johnston right there.
Mike linebacker making a Mike linebacker style play on third down. And sometimes when you play with pace, it can come back to get you. Beautiful scrape around the guard and defensive tackle to make a sure play.
So that's going to bring on Evan Staley.
And that's one thing both sides of the ball, Baylor and West Virginia, they haven't been able to quite run the ball effectively like the coaches want. But, I mean, it's been a running back by committee by both sides. So we'll see which running back can pop a big one and get those explosive runs that they're looking for.
Staley on for a 44-yard field goal attempt. And that is no good. So the Baylor defense, despite a couple of penalties, comes up with a stop after the missed field goal by Staley. It's still 7-0 West Virginia. A missed field goal. It stays 7-0. 8:35 to go here in this first quarter as Baylor gets the ball back. DeMarco, what should we watch for?
Jalen Hurd. He is a dynamic athlete. He's probably the best athlete on this field today, running the ball, catching the ball. He can do it all. They're going to try to find ways to get the ball in his hands and let him do his job. On the other side, you got David Long Jr., tackling machine, talking with the defensive coordinator, Coach Gibson. He loves him. He wants to be on the field at all times, and he is always around the ball.
On first down, the give is to Hasty, and Hasty gets a first down and more up to the 39 as he gets 12, tackled by Kenny Robinson. And that was a good read there by Charlie Brewer.
You said it right before the break, DeMarco. You're waiting for one of these backs to pop one. That was pretty close.
Yeah, Jane, he's right there. He leads the Big 12 with 19 receptions on the year.
Again, it's given to Hasty. And Hasty gets five on first down. Kenny Bigelow with the tackle.
Hasty's kind of their lead back. He's a guy that's very elusive. He can run, he can catch, but they're going to find ways to get him the ball. I like this guy. He can break the long run, Petros.
He can, and that hair goes flying behind him when he does it. Those are some pretty elaborate braids.
I think they call those dreads.
Yeah, I think they call those dreads.
Those are dreads, but they're braided in the middle. I know the difference.
I forgot. You're from California. You know. You went to USC. What was I thinking?
Second down and five.
That was in the cornrow era.
The pass deflected, intercepted. Picked up by Keith Washington. Off the hands of Denzel Mims, and Washington capitalized.
Mims has had a hard time catching those balls over the middle, taking big hits from an active Mountaineer secondary.
Yeah, I mean, this is a slant. Mims is one of their best receivers, not looking the ball in, got on him early, but he has to reach out and catch the ball. He can't allow the ball to be caught with his chest, and that's where he messed up, getting his eyes off the ball. And Keith Washington, right place, right time. I'll take that.
At the end, it looked like Mims may have tried to rip the ball back away from Keith Washington. And, of course, on turnovers, the officials look at everything.
I think that's going to stay West Virginia's ball. I think he may have hit the ground when Mims tried to regain possession, but I'm pretty sure Keith Washington had that ball to the ground.
The replay official is Gary Brown. And they will say it's West Virginia ball. So they take over at their own 45. Greer with time. Steps up over the middle, delivers the strike, and the pass is caught by T.J. Simmons. And Simmons is down to the 38 of Baylor, a 17-yard completion.
What a cannon. He fired that ball right in there. But great job by T.J. Simmons coming back to the ball, coming back to his route, and not just standing there waiting for the ball to hit him.
Greer again, this time all the way down the field, just out of the reach of his big target, David Sills, off the fingertips.
David Sills usually finds a way to make that play, and Greer usually finds a way to drop it in there. But this just goes to show, if West Virginia can keep him clean in the pocket, he'll pick you apart. That's a great route by a great receiver.
Yeah, I mean, just kind of got away from a little bit. Maybe could have dove, but I mean, Sills, he's one of their best receivers. He leads the team in the Big 12 with 7 touchdown receptions, so I'm sure they're going to find ways to get him the ball in the end zone.
Second down and 10. They took the shot on first down. Little shovel pass here, Tevin Bush. Bush gets to the sideline, he gets shoved out. Picks up the first down, gets 11. Tevin Bush did not play at Iowa State 2 weeks ago. And he is in there on that little shovel pass for the first down.
Spadle does a great job at getting guys the ball in different ways. Just another wrinkle right there. I mean, just finding a jet sweep, getting it over, but big block also on the edge by Brown, the true freshman.
Greer, the lob to the end zone. And it's incomplete to Marcus Sims. Sims wanted a flag. It looked like Sims actually stepped out of bounds.
Yeah, Derek Thomas did a great job. He's pressing up, knowing that he's running the go route. He doesn't fake on the double pump, but he just stays with him. He stepped out of bounds, so even if he would have caught it, it would have been an incomplete penalty. But Spadle does such a great job at designing plays, finding ways to get different guys the ball, and he's so enamored by what Will Greer can do on a daily basis.
Second down and 10. Greer, delayed handoff here to Letty Brown. Up the middle. He'll get 3 yards. Terrell Bernard with the tackle.
Letty Brown, more of their short yardage guy. 51 carries on the year out of Philadelphia.
Four
backs that are going to run the ball tonight for Jake Spavadal's offense. But the strength is that guy and the wide receivers.
Martell Pettaway is in on 3rd and 8.
You see that double fake count? He's trying to see what this defensive secondary is giving him. Man-to-man, cover two. What are they going to show him so he can change it up if he need to?
Pressure coming. It's picked up. The pass is incomplete. No flags. There's a nice job by Martell Pettaway coming across to pick up one of the blitzers.
And that was one of those moments where Phil Snow changed it up and changed the picture, so to speak, on Will Greer and had some success on 3rd down.
And that's what you have to do. You have to make sure that Greer is not comfortable in that pocket because he's such a smart quarterback. He knows when the pressure's coming. He has full control to change the plays, give different signals. But Phil Snow does a great job sending some pressure, backing out on that series.
Evan Staley from 40 has it blocked. So Staley's now 0-for-2 on the night in field goals. Misses from 44, has the 40-yarder blocked, and it's James Lynch who got the hand on it.
That's huge for this Baylor team. 2 missed field goals there, just a push inside. Those are some big guys upside, but just
look at
getting
that
hands up.
Yeah, great job by Lynch, just forcing his way in there. We said he was country strong, and Coach Rule knows it too. Phil Snow there, everybody excited on the Baylor sideline. Dana Holgerson wishes the offense stayed out there a little longer.
That's huge, though. 2 back-to-back missed field goals. Now, offense, can they capitalize on this momentum? Their defense has been playing well since that first drive ended. Let's see if this offense can get going, get Brewer going.
They take over at the 23-yard line. Brewer, with plenty of time, taking the shot over the middle, nearly picked off. Jumping, that was Josh Norwood. He had 2 hands on it, and he'll say, man, I should have caught that ball.
I understand taking the shot there, but if you're Baylor and you've had this few snaps in the game, run the ball. Give your defense a little rest.
You got to find ways to get Jalen Hurd the ball. He's the guy who's leading this team in yards. He's the guy that's going to make things happen. But you ran him on that post route. Maybe give him a slant, give him a hitch. But I don't mind them taking a shot there on 1st down. But Josh Norwood just does a great job just reading the quarterback's eyes and making a play on the ball there.
Brewer, design quarterback run, and Kenny Bigelow was the one who was able to reach out his arm and make the stop, his 3rd tackle of this first quarter already. How about this for Charlie Brewer? He's 0-for-4 to open up this game. Ventures, you said he takes care of the ball. He normally does. Already interception, wasn't his fault, off his receiver's hands.
They do not have their bearings offensively right now. They desperately need to convert this 3rd down to keep their defense on the sideline.
3rd and 9. Brewer with time. He does find a receiver. And this time it's Marcus Jones for a big-time 1st down, 22 yards.
Brewer's a great quarterback. Second-year guy. He's taking his time. He has time in the pocket, steps up, and he finds his tight end coming across the middle. Great play right there. And huge play. You know, 3rd down, they haven't been good. They haven't sustained drives, but this is the momentum that they need to carry to finish this drive out.
Jamichael Hasty in the backfield, 1st and 10 from the 46. Brewer over the middle to Hurd. And that's intercepted. Torius Avery back the other way. And a flag is thrown when Avery goes down. Jalen Hurd, the intended receiver.
Well, they've been going over the middle a lot with the football, and they haven't had as much success. Charlie Brewer's been pretty accurate.
During the return, holding number 6 of the intercepting team, 10 yards from the end of the run, 1st down, West Virginia.
And I don't know if Jalen Hurd didn't expect that ball or it just came out a little hot from Charlie Brewer, but it got right through the wickets, it seemed, in his hands. And there you see the hold at the end of the play there. That's Dravon Askew-Henry on the hold. It's hard to block when you don't usually do it. There's Coach Gibson with some love for Toyas Avery. Another interception for Coach Rule's team.
First time in Charlie Brewer's career he's thrown two interceptions in a game. He's thrown two in this quarter. The pass to tight end Wesco. Wesco stretching out, gets down to the 10-yard line. Trevon Wesco, there is a flag on the play.
That's a big tight end, 280
offside
pounds.
Offside, defense, number 38. Penalties declined, result of the play, first down.
All right, so we talked about the importance of that first down conversion on third down before, but now the takeaway, and look what West Virginia has a chance to do right here.
It's another wrinkle right there, just finding Wesco, having that receiver come in motion to see if they're man in zone, and then Wesco line up the seam. Red zone, you got to watch out for Seals here. They have a great connection, he and Greer.
Petaway takes the handoff. He'll get back to the line of scrimmage. B.J. Thompson with the tackle. You mentioned red zone and red zone efficiency for this team. When they are in the red zone, typically they will punch it in.
A lot of weapons, especially Sills, and the communication he has with Weir Greer.
Hands off again to Petaway. And Petaway will pick up 2 yards. Clay Johnston with his fourth tackle. This defense for Baylor, they're putting up a fight here.
Yeah, the Baylor front does a good job of not allowing the West Virginia offensive line to build to their linebackers.
Definitely led by James Lynch and Ira Lewis. This defensive front, they're going to give this West Virginia offensive line a lot of problems in the run game. Let's see if they can control the line of scrimmage all night.
Sills in the slot. Greer has to get rid of it, facing pressure, throws the back of the end zone, and it's incomplete. T.J. Simmons came down with it, but Derek Thomas was there covering him. The transfer out of Temple.
I know that was an incomplete ball, but Will Grigg feeling pressure in the middle, but the fact that he can just lob this ball up and get out of pressure, I mean, he's an athletic guy. He doesn't get a lot of credit for his mobility inside that pocket, but he has great touch on the ball to put that ball exactly where he needs to be.
It wasn't the right place, no doubt about it. Would have been a great catch.
The third field goal attempt of the quarter here for Evan Staley, this time from 25 yards. And he does connect. So they finally punch one in for the uprights. It's 10-0 West Virginia here in the first quarter. It's only 10-0 right now, West Virginia leading Baylor, but it could be a lot worse if you think about it. Two turnovers. It feels like West Virginia has had the ball the entire first quarter.
Well, Baylor's only really had the ball 10 snaps, and they've only moved it about 21 yards. So they need a lot more from their offense. They need to possess the football a lot more. And Coach Gibson loves it because his defense has barely been out there. He hasn't had to make a whole bunch of calls. He could save a lot of that stuff for later in the game.
Only 3 points off those two turnovers for West Virginia. Evan Staley to kick off. Trevor White back deep with Chris Platt. The fair catch is signaled and made by Platt, so they will start at the 25-yard line. And let's check in with Jen Hale down on the field.
Justin, so many fabulous collegiate traditions here at West Virginia, and one is a hard hat in a glass case right behind the defensive bench. If you get an interception, you get to sign the hard hat and don it, and it has been a very busy hat so far this game. Both Avery and Washington getting that honor today. And, of course, this defense thrilled at the way they responded to adversity, coming out, throwing punches, doing exactly what they need to do to get this squad back in gear.
That is awesome. Thanks, Jen.
A lot of mining here in West Virginia. That's appropriate. I like it better than the turnover chain.
On first down, the handoff is to Jalen Hurd, and they want to get him the ball somehow, some way. They give it to him right there, and he picks up 14.
And this is their playmaker. He can run inside, outside, but this is a big, strong guy coming at you. You're not going to want to tackle him high, but when he gets a full steam ahead, he's not going down easy.
All knees and elbows.
Kept by Brewer. And Brewer will get a couple yards on first down. Darius Stills with a tackle.
And they want to run the ball. They just haven't had much success when it comes to a three-man front. This three-man front can be very confusing for the offensive line, knowing who's that fourth or fifth guy down. But you have to just have great communication at the line of scrimmage, letting your running back know, hey, this guy's down, he's down. You got to figure out who's the fourth guy coming at all times.
Could be any of these guys end up down on the line of scrimmage. And absolutely, this offensive line has had trouble with three down defenses.
Brewer again keeps it on the zone read. He gets back to the line of scrimmage, so third and long is coming up once again. The tackle made by Darius Stills. Darius Stills and his brother Dante Stills on this defensive front. The son of Gary, who played here at West Virginia and then in the NFL with the Kansas City Chiefs.
They're local. They're from in the state. They love that here in Morgantown.
Baylor converted on third and nine on their previous drive. Now they're trying to convert on third and seven here.
They're bringing pressure here.
Here it comes. And Brewer gets taken down at the 35. Giovanni Stewart was the first one there. Trayvon Askew-Henry there as well. A loss of six.
They picked up the first pressure, but not the second.
Yeah, Askew-Henry coming off the edge. He's a guy who started and played in 45 games, but this is what Tony Gibson wants to do. He wants to confuse Brewer, sending guys at different levels, and Brewer just has to get the ball out of his hands. He sees it, but you have to have a route that can break out in order to beat that pressure when it gets there.
Gaylitz on to punt again. Marcus Sims, fair catch, signaled and made at the 28-yard line. A 36-yard punt for Gaylitz. This Mountaineer team enters this game after starting the season 5-0. They did have a game canceled against NC State due to Hurricane Florence. And then they go to Iowa State, and they have one of their worst performances in a long time, losing 30-14. And now you have this upcoming at Texas next week, versus TCU in 2 weeks, at Oklahoma State, and then versus Oklahoma. That's why this game is so critical for Dana Holgorsen and the Mountaineers.
And this is what they need to get back going. Before they play those tough opponents, can they get back going with timing and rhythm on the offensive side, on the defensive side? They have to get back to winning, but they have a tough road ahead.
Trevon Wesco with the catch and the run of 9 yards.
There's another West Virginia guy, and they've done a much better job of handling the pressure that Baylor's bringing than they did in Ames a couple weeks ago. That was very difficult for them.
Second down and one. Final play of this first quarter. Greer. He's got room to run, but he's going to pass instead to the sideline to T.J. Simmons. T.J. Simmons makes the catch and gets the first down for five. 1 second remaining. And now the clock strike zero. So the first quarter is over. A lot happened in that first quarter. West Virginia scored in the first minute a touchdown. They missed a couple of field goals, made another one. They lead 10-0 over Baylor at the end of one. Tavon Austin, who electrified the crowd here in Morgantown, he is back in the house. Hit a big game against Baylor back in 2012. Petros was in the house for that one.
It was pretty amazing. I saw him move him to tailback to play against Oklahoma and run for about 280 yards.
Whoa, Petros. Don't mention that ever again, all right?
Greer down the sideline. Going up to make the catch is Sills. What an adjustment by David Sills. A 42-yard completion.
David Sills with great timing goes up and grabs the ball. This ball was floated a little high and left in the air by Will Greer, but don't worry, Sills says, I'll make it right, goes up and grabs it. That's a huge catch to get the first down.
And now on first down, the handoff to Kennedy McCoy gets back to the line of scrimmage. What's amazing about David Sills is this is a guy who is a highly recruited quarterback coming out of high school, and now he is an NFL prospect as a receiver.
Well, it's from the seventh grade, really. I mean, he had a lot of hype. Lane Kiffin offered him a scholarship at USC. Of course, he didn't have to talk about it, but Sills got to talk about it a whole bunch. Holgerson flirted with him playing quarterback.
The shot to the end zone, overthrows his intended receiver, Dominique Maiden. Maiden was open if that throw is on target, and Greer knows it.
That one got a little away from him, but Maiden made an amazing move running a post corner, and he was wide open. If Greer could have may have taken too much touch, you see here, post, and then corner, and he just... That was a great route. I mean, wide open.
You saw everybody going with Sills. Everybody's looking at Sills near the goal line, and Maiden was able to slip out there. Really nice body control.
Not throws you usually see Greer miss.
Third down. Greer, he gets sacked. Taken to the ground by James Lynch. What a big play right there, as they may have taken him out of field goal range. A loss of 15 on that sack.
And talking to Coach Spath last week, this is where Greer gets in trouble. He's a competitive guy. Reminds me of Romo when it comes to, I don't want to throw the ball away. I want to make a play happen. But at times, you always have to live to fight another down and know the situation, more importantly. You're in field goal position. Throw the ball away. Let's kick three and move on.
Good job by Lynch, not jumping, not leaving his feet, finishing that play.
This will be a 47-yard field goal attempt here for Evan Staley. He's 1 for 3. And Staley's kick from 47 is good. He's now 2 for 4. They don't get 7, but they do get 3. It's 13-0 Mountaineers. It's 13-0 West Virginia over Baylor, and I have to admit this. I think it's the first time I've seen 4 field goal attempts in the span of about 17 minutes. The Mountaineer, one of the great mascots in the country, you got to think he may have a squallet in his back pocket to keep his money over there.
That's awesome. That would be a great Halloween costume. If I can borrow that, that would be awesome there.
That's real full buckskin there.
I believe it.
Evan Staley. To kick off to Chris Platt and Trevor White. This will go into the end zone. The Baylor Bears, 1-11 last year. They started out really well this year, 3-1. And a heartbreak loss in Austin, 23-17. They made a heck of a comeback, and as Jen mentioned at the top of the show, 2 more wins and they can go bowling, which would be quite a turnaround for Matt Rhule and this Bears team.
He's done an amazing job this second season after battling all those horrible things that happened around the university, helping a youthful team just navigate in this hard division. I mean, he's done an amazing job for year 2.
Charlie Brewer under center. Hand off to Jamichael Hasty, and Hasty gets hit at the line by Kenny Robinson. That's the second time Robinson's come up with a big hit. One in the secondary, now one at the line.
He's a physical player coming back in. He can play the run game. He can cover as well, but he's a physical free safety, 6'2", 198 pounds.
Baylor's got to find some offensive stability here. Their defense has been really heroic, actually, in the first half, but I'm not sure how much longer they could take these 3-and-outs.
Hasty again, and Hasty gets hit in the backfield again. This time it's David Long, the leader of that defense.
David Long, that's his 11th tackle for loss there. Leads the team in total tackles with 61, 3 sacks. But here you see, no one blocks him. He has a great feel for this running game, and he's a very smart player. Talking to Coach Gibson, he's a coach on the field. He loves to practice. They love everything about him. He's a hard, hard-working guy and loves football. But more importantly, he's a physical linebacker and the leader of this defense.
Back-to-back tackles for losses. Leads to 3rd and 12. Pressure coming again. That's 3 tackles for a loss in a row. It's 2 in a row for David Long.
That's That's a great call by Coach Gibson. He brought the boundary corner here, and you see the running back goes out to get the boundary corner, leaves David Long with no one blocking him, but unbelievable job by Coach Gibson dialing that blitz up, and they just brought more than what the Baylor Bears offense can block. I mean, you got to give them a lot of credit for that.
Galitz to punt from the goal line. They bring pressure. He just gets it away. Sims able to dive and make the catch, and Sims took a hit as he went down after a 37-yard punt. And you could see Marcus Sims right now is in pain on the turf for West Virginia. The training staff comes out to look at Sims as the hit was delivered by the long snapper, Ross Madison. David Long, back-to-back tackles for a loss. That sack for a loss of 8 forced the punt. So great starting field position here for West Virginia at the 48 of Baylor. On first down, the handoff to Alex Sinkfield. And Alex Sinkfield, who missed his last four games, is back in. Let's go back to that previous play, though.
As a running back, Hasty's here. Your responsibility is to be inside out blocking here. You have to start with your first key, and that's Long. You have to let the quarterback take care of that corner blitz. But there, Hasty has to protect this guy inside. That's why that protection broke down.
And another three and out for the Baylor Bears. And how much can this defense handle?
Well, they just gave up an 8-yard run. Now second down and 2. David Sills in motion. Flag is thrown. Greer throws it away. And let's wait to see what this flag is as Greer runs all the way down to his own 27, and he's kind of flexing that left knee.
There is no foul for intentional grounding. There was a receiver in the area.
That is what Jake Spavital, the offensive coordinator, was talking about, DeMarco. Get rid of the ball. You don't see anything. Yeah. And I know you want to make a play. I know you want to be great and load up those stats and move this offense. But every once in a while, you have to live to fight another day.
Yeah, last week, they gave up 7 sacks, and 5 or 6 of those was on Greer. If he would have just thrown the ball away there, you see, during the bye week, they had a long talk and discussion with him. Hey, you don't want to take your playmaking ability away, but sometimes live to fight another day. Throw the ball away, and let's move on.
Letty Brown and Alex Sinkfield are in here on 1st and 10. There was a penalty against Baylor, and the handoff to Sinkfield up the middle. And Sinkfield will get 2 yards.
They didn't tell us about the Baylor penalty. They told us about the intentional grounding. There wasn't a penalty.
Sinkfield is back after missing the last 4 games due to an injury, but he has the ability to hit the home run. The freshman, smaller guy, 5'9", but they think he can be their explosive back that takes it the distance at any time.
Guys, how about this? West Virginia, 21 plays in Baylor territory, yet only 13 points. They swing it out to Sinkfield, and Sinkfield can't go anywhere. Well, he gets tossed to the ground by Greg Roberts, and he's going to lose a couple yards.
Yeah, that's kind of what Iowa State did. They let him drive the ball on occasion, but they didn't let him score points. And looking at this Baylor team, that's what they're doing. They're nickel and diming them, having some big drives, but they're not giving up those touchdowns. They're giving up one touchdown on the first drive, and the last 2 opportunities have been field goals.
Coach Rule's defense has been the bamboo. Bend, but do not break.
3rd and 10. Sinkfield, good effort. A good run, but will come up short of the first down marker as he gets 7. Henry Black with the stop.
Running the ball there, they knew that they were going to be in 4-down territory. Let's try to get some yards here. Let's see if we can get into a 4th and 3, 4th and 4 situation to let our quarterback do what he does best.
Maybe look for David Sills. All the receivers stacked on the near side. Letty Brown in the backfield. Greer keeps it. Greer able to slip a tackle and get the first down. The 5th-year senior quarterback out of Charlotte, North Carolina, was able to get the first down.
How about the stop move there?
He does a great job of reading that defensive end And then, let me give a little shake. I have some mobility to him. Not a running back. I'm a throw, but I can make a guy miss, stop his feet, going to get the first down. But that's that competitive nature that we're talking about, not going down, not giving up on the play.
That's
going
to hurt Terrell Bernard in the film room.
Now taking the shot to the end zone to Sills. Touchdown, West Virginia. From Will Greer to David Sills, the eighth time they've connected for a touchdown this year. And the Mountaineers finally punch one in again.
Just the touch. Just watch the touch on this ball. Unbelievable job putting the ball in the breadbasket, dropping it in, and Sills makes an easy catch. I mean, you can't put that ball any better than Greer did. Finding his best target when it comes to touchdowns at David Sills, who's running the go route. And if you're Baylor, you got to switch it up a little bit more, confuse him just enough.
Well, we talked about bend but don't break. I think maybe it's just exhaustion. Sills with his eighth touchdown catch of the year. It's 20-0 Mountaineers. Well, David Sills has the most touchdown catches in the FBS since 2017. He now has 28 career touchdowns, which is now one shy of Tavon Austin.
Watch him work at the line of scrimmage, takes that inside route, puts his head down and runs, and then looks for the football. You're only going to keep Greer and Sills down for so long that close to the red zone. And I got to say, I'm not putting this on the Baylor defense right now. It's on the Baylor offense to get some time out there. They've only had 7:41 time of possession.
No doubt about it. As this one goes through the end zone again, I think I'm more impressed. You almost said grills. That was like the new, what is that, like Kardashian?
Will Greer. David Sills.
This offense usually sustains long drives. I mean, they average 33 minutes a game. That's second in the Big 12 in time of possession. So, I mean, punt the ball, intercept. They're just not getting going. They've had a okay drive this past drive, but they're just not getting anything going. Credit to this West Virginia defense.
John Lovett is in at tailback, and Lovett takes the handoff. And Lovett will get 4 yards, second down and six.
Lovett's pretty lengthy running back, 6 feet tall, incredible lead when he runs the ball. Really a one-cut runner, and a guy that's physical could take a little bit out of a defense. In fact, he might play a little defense tonight is what we heard.
Second down and seven. Brewer rolling out. Instead of getting rid of it, runs out and is going to take a loss of 6 yards. He could have just thrown that ball away, and it would have been just down to see another day.
Yeah, that's not what you want to see. Now it's third and long. He had a manageable third down potentially, but I don't understand that play by Brewer there. I mean, he has to get rid of the ball. He's made a lot of great decisions throughout the course of the year, but tonight, for some reason, he's had a couple overthrows, and he's not playing like himself tonight.
There is former Baylor Bear Jeff Nixon, one of the offensive coordinators for the Bears, trying to figure it out upstairs.
Charlie Brewer has to throw on third and long, and incomplete pass. His target was Tyquan Thornton.
Tried to hit him on the back shoulder, but he threw the ball a little too far outside, out of bounds. And, yeah, Brewer just off to a shaky start right now, along with the rest of this Baylor offense.
And this goes back to, Petros, what you were saying. This is not on the Baylor defense. This is on the offense right now, because this is yet another three and out. The defense is going to be exhausted.
Yeah, we try to talk about complementary football, and you get especially exhausted on the road.
Drew Gaylitz, a high punt. Marcus Sims, the fair catch, as he falls to the ground at the 33-yard line. A 45-yard punt, but the fourth three and out for Baylor tonight. DeMarco wants to hear what you guys have to say about that, Oklahoma.
Oh, I thought he wanted to hear about Appy State.
West Virginia takes over. Will Greer on first down, the handoff is to Luddy Brown, who gets 2 yards.
Tight end.
Good push in the backfield by James Lynch to make the running back cut up, but Heck of a job. That's one of their more physical and more athletic defensive linemen right there.
Yeah, he's their best guy. He's the straw that stirs the drink for this whole defense, and they've had their work cut out for him.
He's got time. Down the sideline for Sills. Sills makes the catch to the end zone again. 65 yards. And with that touchdown, he has now tied Tavon Austin for second all-time here at West Virginia.
I'm sure that was on his mind coming into this game, but Sills is just a fantastic receiver. Onesie, great route, and what a throw by Greer. Another explosive play, but impressive. This is an impressive offense. I mean, they got weapons. They've thrown the ball to 8 or 9 different guys already, and Tavon Austin, there he is. Just got a new former teammate. Just got a new teammate in Amari Cooper, so.
The extra point is good. Sills now 4 catches, 141 yards, 2 touchdowns, and watch him.
Sills runs a great route, stutter, then he gets on top of the receiver or the DB and makes an unbelievable catch over the shoulder. Greer puts it right where he wants to, but these guys have an amazing connection and they know each other. They know where the ball is going to be. They spend a lot of time before practice, during practice, after practice, working on these throws and signals. There's some signals that we're talking to Spav about. Hey, we don't know what they're doing. They have a great connection. We don't mess with
those
guys.
They're doing their own thing and the coaches don't know on the sideline. Jamison Houston just totally confused by Sills. He has these guys eaten out of the palm of his hand, these DBs, with all the releases he has at the line of scrimmage. And you wonder, when Sills left this program to try to play quarterback at El Camino College in Southern California, if he ever saw himself coming back here and catching the ball and breaking records in front of Tavon Austin.
I think he made the right decision to come back and play receiver. He'll be playing on Sundays for sure. That's a big-time receiver there.
Dana Holgorsen compared him to Chris Hogan of the New England Patriots. That type of a receiver is Sills. A short kick. Chris Platt takes it at the 9. Platt gets a block. And he takes it across the 30 up to the 31-yard line.
This is a pretty big ladder to climb now for the Baylor Bears. They have shown no promise on offense as far as being able to move the ball down the field or sustain a drive even. And you can give Tony Gibson a lot of credit for that, but I'm sure if you talk to Matt Rhule about it, when Jed talks to him at halftime, he's going to say, we are not ourselves. So we've got to find a way to get a first down or two and just restore some order going into the half.
I mean, that's an unbelievable stat right there. Just 40 total yards of offense. Brewer, pump fake, now throws over the middle, and that is picked off. Shea Campbell with the interception, the third of the game.
Wow. Only making his second start, made his first start last week. The junior had 12 tackles and 2 TFLs. Comes up with his first interception, and a big interception, but I just don't know what Brewer's doing right here. He feels some pressure inside. He has time, but he tries to throw to his running back who's running full speed. You can't do that, let alone throw behind him, but Brewer just, he's not himself right now. I don't know what's going on with this offense, and the whole offense just seems to be a little out of sync, but you got to give Tony Gibson and this defense credit. They're making big plays at all times tonight.
You got the hard hat.
Got the hard hat. 3 interceptions for Brewer tonight. He had 3 the entire season coming in. And Greer will throw this one away. He did have a receiver in the vicinity in Sills.
They were trying to take a shot there. They're not going to take the foot off the pedal here. They're going to keep things going.
Well, that's exactly what Dana Holgorsen told us. With this team, we have to keep the pedal to the metal. We got to keep our foot on the gas, because it's not as if we don't know how to do clock management, but this team just likes to go, go, go.
Yeah, they don't have that back that can take the ball and run it in between the tackles and eat it. Pettaway heard what I was about to say there. So he goes, let me take this ball, let me run it to the end zone with an explosive run there. 5'9", 212 pounds, averaging 5 yards a carry. Wow. inside zone, that three-man box there, three-man down line, and he makes an unbelievable cut in the open field. But wow, they're running the ball well. This is what they want to do. Spavital said, hey, we have to run the ball. We want to throw it with our weapons on the outside, but if we can't run the ball, we won't be the offense that we're capable of being.
Well, right now, this offense has put up 34 points. It all started with the interception by Shea Campbell. Gave the offense great field position, and Petaway with a second touchdown of the year. On a chilly night, the Mountaineer is going to stay warm doing all these push-ups with his team scoring so many points.
That's a new Mountaineer, Justin. That's Trevor Keese. He's been the Mountaineer since April. That's a brand new Mountaineer.
This offense is rolling right now.
Look at those push-ups, DeMarco. That's weak. Look, he's got to straighten up the back.
It's not bad. He has a lot of leather on him.
Zip up the back of your leg.
The leather adds about 10 pounds to him, so, you know, I think those are pretty solid push-ups.
He's going to run out of gunpowder. He's been firing that thing so much. And now Baylor's just in survival mode, trying to get into the tunnel at halftime and talk over what's going on with their quarterback and why their offense can't stay on the field.
This will give them good starting field position. Maybe? No, it takes the great bounce into the end zone. It looked like it was going out of bounds, but nothing is going Baylor's way right now.
No, Coach Rule is going to need that Just for Men beard and mustache comb on his goatee at halftime, because this has been one of the most difficult halves to watch of Baylor football in recent memory. And this is a team that has struggled, but they've gotten much better, and they've had a much more promising year. Very disappointing half for Baylor Nation and all Bears fans here.
Oh, they made a quarterback switch there. Yeah.
They brought in Jalen McClendon, the transfer out of NC State. So three turnovers in the half, three interceptions, and now McClendon on the run. Diving forward, he'll get 9 yards on first down.
Tough decision to make a quarterback change when Charlie Brewer's been the guy. He's had some success, but Coach Rule, hey, we need some momentum. We got to get something going offensively. Right now, Brewer's not giving us that.
And there is the quarterback sneak. Keeps on going.
Now, West Virginia didn't get to play North Carolina State because of the weather, but this guy came from North Carolina State, transfer from there. The Wolfpack, Jalen McClendon, has played some this year, thrown the ball about 40 times, three touchdowns and a pick, and they do feel good about playing him. And you can see his legs bring a little extra dimension that could restore a little bit of order for the Bears.
Here he is, back to pass, and he throws incomplete. Josh Norwood there on the coverage again. Pass intended for Denzel Mims.
Coach Gibson, he's bringing pressure. He knows. You see these three linebackers there, they're all coming. They finally sort of pick it up, but you see Long there gets through. But he's bringing pressure. He knows, I want to get these quarterbacks uncomfortable. The only way I can do that, bring pressure. This right side of this offensive line, they've been well. But the left side, they've had a lot of troubles with that left side of the line of scrimmage.
Treston Ebner is in at tailback. McClendon again trying to run and just trying to get back to the line of scrimmage. So third and 10 is coming up here for Baylor. David Long there with a tackle, as well as Ezekiel Rose.
Well, Brewer completed more passes to West Virginia players than his own players, 3-1. And McClendon doesn't seem to be faring any better. Huge third down just to stay on the field and survive.
You see these guys, they're disguising well. They're coming. They're trying to make sure McClendon knows, hey, we're coming. What are you going to do?
So Michael Hastie's back in at tailback on third and 10.
Now they're checking out. They saw Baylor make a check, so we're checking out.
They just get the play off. McClendon dumps it off to Hastie. And Hastie, nowhere to go. David Long was there again, sniffing it out.
What a great job by David Long, being patient there and playing Hastie inside out, not letting him get up underneath it and making a sure tackle. We talked to Coach Gibson about
David Long says he really takes on Gibson's personality out there on the football field, and oftentimes he's got to tell him to calm down and just enjoy playing college football.
That's a good sign when you have to tell one of your players, hey, stop going so hard, stop doing that so fast, you're messing up the play. So they love David Long. He's a big-time player for this team.
Sills is back. He lets this one bounce into the end zone. Well, this game, the Mountaineers got off to a quick start. They scored in the first minute. Gary Jennings from Will Grier. Grier over 300 yards passing in the first half. The Mountaineers' defense, they've been everywhere. Three sacks. They've intercepted Charlie Brewer three times. And how about David Sills? Four catches, two touchdowns, 141 yards in the first half. This is the fifth game this year that West Virginia has gone over 300 yards of offense in the first half. On first down, the handoff is to Tevin Bush on the end around, and there goes Bush down the sideline. They're going to mark him down at the two. A 78-yard run by Tevin Bush, chased down by Kendrick Bonds.
Smallest guy on the field making one of the biggest plays of the night. Great job by Vaughn's not giving up and making that play on him, but just a jet sweep that goes almost to the house. Good effort by Vaughn's.
That was good effort. Knowing this Baylor team and the way that they play, they don't give up. No matter what the situation and the score is, they're going to fight and try to rally as much as they can, but that was just another great wrinkle by Coach Babb there, the offensive coordinator, finding ways to get the ball in their athletes' hands.
A timeout's going to be called here by West Virginia.
I think they think he was in. He's
winding down.
I think they think he might have scored.
Timeout. West Virginia. 30-second timeout.
They mark him down at the one. First and goal from the one.
Nice timing between Grier and Bush on the jet sweep. Everybody gets out and blocks very well.
It's two tight ends. Wesco and Haskins made huge blocks to spring that long run there. Those two tight ends, they don't get a lot of balls, but those are blocking guys that when they can get a ball, they're excited about it. But just an unbelievable wrinkle once again.
Check out the knee.
Knee is down.
He's short. Good call.
See if they bring the big true freshman in. Already has three rushing touchdowns of the year. Leads this team. Brown, number four, 5'11", 215 pounds.
It's Alex Sinkfield in at tailback. Under center is Grier. Grier will keep it. Gets pushed from behind. And he still waiting for the call. Touchdown! Will Grier with a one-yard touchdown run. He does still have some powder left.
I like this wrinkle. Get up under center. When you're going to run a quarterback sneak or when you're inside the three-yard line, get up under center. Even though you're multiple and you can do a lot of shotgun, you don't have to prove it there. On the goal line, I like that call from Dana Holgerson and his OC, Jix Babadon.
First rushing touchdown of the year for Will Grier. Wasn't quite the push.
Bush had about a 90-yard push on that, that jet sweep.
The extra point is good. 41-0, West Virginia. Rushing the Baylor Bears here on a Thursday night in Morgantown. Matt Rhule has that look of bewilderment right now on his face, and you don't blame him. 3:09 to go here in the second quarter as Dana Holgerson's team leads 41 to nothing.
Look at this frustration that West Virginia and all these touchdowns has let out on this Baylor football team. West Virginia wildly frustrated at Iowa State. They had such a rough time moving the ball. You see the yardage differential there. And they have shown everything that they didn't on the road here at home tonight on a Thursday.
Luke Hogan will kick off here. Mistake right there by Chris Platt. The flag is thrown.
I think he was out of bounds when it hit him.
Well, when you catch it, you can have one leg out to make sure the ball is out of bounds. So he actually does a great job. Heads up play there by Chris Platt. If you catch it with 1 foot in and 1 foot out, it's just as good as the ball rolling out of bounds. So it'll be a penalty for the Baylor Bears.
That's a good call because I thought he was completely out.
Kicking team. The receiver was standing in out of bounds. Touch the ball. The ball will be placed on the 35-yard line. First down.
He does a great job getting to the sideline, having that awareness. Hey, I'm close to the sideline. Let me put 1 foot in, 1 foot out, and make sure I get this penalty to get this offense hopefully moving in the right direction, which they haven't been able to do the last couple of drives or all night.
Just let Will Grier stay on the sideline for about a minute or two.
Jalen McClendon is still in at quarterback. Relieving Charlie Brewer. The handoff to Hasty. And Hasty gets the first down, still on his feet as he takes the hit from Akeem Bailey. A 14-yard run for Jamichael Hasty.
As hard as it is, you have to stay with your game plan. We know the score is 41-0, but you can't just go out there and throw the ball every single time. You have to establish some sort of running game in order to have success in the passing game.
And they're going to be a run-oriented team now with Charlie Brewer on the sideline.
Player down on the ground. It looks like Giovanni Stewart. Don't forget, coming up, we've got the State Farm Halftime Report. The guys are standing by in the studio. Rob Stone, Dave Wonstadt, Matt Leinart, Robert Smith. A lot of highlights from this game, not many for Baylor, though.
Yeah, when we talk Sams, we talk Jennings, we talk the receivers for the West Virginia, but Baylor, they have a lot of guys. They have Platt, they have Thornton, they have Hurd, they have Mims, they have a lot of core guys that they have to find ways to get them the ball. They haven't been able to do that.
We've not seen them at all.
Yeah, we haven't. I mean, the quarterback is throwing interceptions. They're not protecting them, so you have to find ways. As hard as it is, it's 41-0, but you got to get those guys involved.
I got to say, watching Will Grier out there work does remind me a lot of Matt Leinart at USC. A lot of good receivers around him, a guy that delivers a great ball, very cerebral, knew exactly where he wanted to go with the football at all times, and the coaches gave him the freedom to change plays out there.
Yeah, stack Steve Smith. They had a lot of guys. I remember those days.
Gary
glory
Colbert,
days.
Mike
USC.
Williams.
Oh, yeah, they had a lot of players.
Here they give it to Hurd. Hurd looking for a block. A flag is thrown. Josh Norwood came away with his hands up in the air like, what just happened there? He's saying, I got held or something. He's still got his hand up in the air. That's holding offense number 81, Tyquan Thornton.
They just keep shooting themselves in the foot. They go forward, then they take 2 steps back. You just can't hold here. Oh, yeah, he got the cornerback right there. You just got to let him go there and let your athletic player and Jalen Hurd do what he can do with the ball there. But you can't have those penalties, those mistakes.
It's first and 14. McClendon. And it's dropped. Chris Platt was open down the sideline, and he just dropped the ball. It looked like the defender may have gotten in his vision.
Now that just goes to show how rough of a night it's been for the Baylor Bears. Chris Platt, probably the fastest guy out on the field right there. The defender does flash Norwood right in front of his face, but you have to make that play for your team at this point. These are elite wide receivers that don't look it tonight.
Baylor team that is struggling mightily. The dump off Hasty. We'll get back to the original line of scrimmage. A 4-yard pickup, 3rd and 10 coming up as we approach 2 minutes to go here in this first half. And you know what? We were talking about this in the first quarter, really. It was a quarter that was dominated by West Virginia, but the score was still close. All of a sudden, it took its toll on the Baylor defense.
Absolutely, and they play a lot of guys. You know, Phil Snow plays 20, 25 guys on that defense, and they still got fatigued and absolutely run by the Mountaineers. Huge third down here.
McClendon dumps it off again to Hasty. And Hasty gets wrapped up by David Long. Long was right there. Norwood came in to help out. But once again, this West Virginia defense, DeMarco, you had said it even before the game. After meeting with the players and the coaches yesterday, there is a confidence about this team, a sense of urgency from this team that they were going to come out fired up for tonight.
And they were. Talking with these coaches and seeing the players walk around the stadium, we knew what they were going to do. I mean, this team, they have a lot of great veteran players, but these coaching staff, they knew, hey, last week, that wasn't our team. That wasn't the type of team that we are. We have to play better. We have to tackle better. They had 32 missed tackles last week. This tonight, I don't think they have any, so they have to continue to play better, and this is a jump start for them. Talking about that stretch in the Big 12, this is the game that matters for them.
For West Virginia, defensively, they were all over Charlie Brewer. The first interception of the game wasn't Brewer's fault.
It was off
the hands of Mims. And then an overthrow of Jalen Hurd. Toyus Avery on the return. And the third interception behind his running back. And Shea Campbell got to put on the hard hat.
I don't know how Shea caught that. That was an impressive catch, seeing it from that angle. Wow.
Threw it right to him. He didn't know he threw it to him. He didn't know he had the ball. Just nothing going right for Baylor. They had a clear touchdown to Platt on that drive, and now they end up punting the football.
Galitz to punt.
Oh.
We're going to have another flag. The fair catch was signaled and made by Sills, and he got run into by McVay.
Yeah, Jaron McVay either didn't know where the ball was or didn't know Sills was the returner or just caught a bad case of the Baylor Blues here in this first half.
My lip reading skills are really coming into play right now. It's a 15-yard penalty. Automatic first down, obviously.
Clear fair catch call, and McVay just can't get out of the way. Or won't.
And West Virginia will take a knee to end this first half.
And that just goes to show you what kind of first half it was. Justin, two timeouts left and an explosive offense with wide receivers, and they're in a victory formation.
And they are getting the crowd pumped up as they head into the locker room with 20 seconds to go. What a first half it was indeed. Will Greer, 15 of 22, 302 yards, 3 touchdowns. David Sills, 4 catches, 141 yards, 2 touchdowns. 41-0 at the half. Let's get you to L.A. and the guys for the State Farm Halftime Show. Celebrating for West Virginia in that first half, leading 41-0 over Baylor. As we get set to start the third quarter, Justin Kutcher alongside DeMarco Murray and Petros Papadakis. It's cold. I put my jacket on. They didn't bring one.
I'm a football player. I'm used to this.
Well, let's talk about the good, and that, of course, is West Virginia. We talked about Will Greer in the open. He threw for over 300 yards in that first half.
They're clicking on all cylinders. They have to be extremely happy. happy with his offense. Eight different receivers have touched the ball, six different running backs. They move the ball, and they get the ball to their athletes in space. They're allowing guys to get the work done on the edges, inside the tackles as well.
For Baylor, though, Petros, there really hasn't been anything good to talk about.
No, they've been absolutely shelled in this game. They came out in the first quarter and played some pretty good defense, but Coach Rule's defense could not hold up against the tremendous pressure that West Virginia's offense kept putting on them, and their offense's inability to hold the ball at all. Turned the ball over at an unbelievable clip, a very uncharacteristic clip in the first half to the Bears.
Evan Staley to kick off. Chris Platt on the return. And Platt, he fumbles the football. That comes out. Platt is down, laying on the ground.
Wow. They're just turning the ball over. I know it's cold, so sometimes your fingers and hands get numb, but both teams are in these conditions.
West Virginia comes away with the ball.
Unbelievable start.
Wow. The rolling on the field is a fumble. Recovered by the kicking team.
Chase Riley is the one who recovers it.
Chris Platt holding that ball out there with a lot of air under it, coming in like a missile there.
Excuse me, it's Sean Malone.
It was Hakeem Bailey that knocked it loose, coming in like a real.
He put his helmet right on the ball. I know you're supposed to hold on to the ball, but I'm going to side with Platt here. There's nothing you can do when that defender puts his helmet perfectly on that ball. I mean, that's just a hard thing to hold on to.
It is, but there was a lot of air under that ball, too. You got to tuck it under, especially in a game like this where your team has had such a hard time holding on to the rock. Get down. Live to fight another day. It's just not happening for the Bears right now. And guess who's back out there?
Will Greer. On first down, there's a fumble. And covering up is Tevin Bush, trying for that shovel pass again on the jet sweep.
Tevin Bush had a big play on that jet sweep early.
Excuse me, they're going to say it's an incomplete.
Yeah, because it is a forward pass. Technically, you see it's just a little push pass there to the front. And when you drop it, it's not a fumble. Incomplete.
So instead, it's second down and 10.
Great job by Spav. You know, these coaches, they're up all night thinking of all these little wrinkles. If he would have handed it off and dropped it, it would have been a fumble. But when he throws it up in the air like that, that's considered a pass. That's why it's an incomplete.
Greer to Sills, and a good defensive play right there as it's knocked away by Raleigh Tejada. And let's go down to the field and check in with Jen Hale.
Justin, Baylor's quarterback switch at the end of the first half was not strategic. Charlie Brewer is being evaluated for a head injury right now. He is out for the rest of the game. Meanwhile, although West Virginia looks like they're sitting pretty, Dana Holgorsen reminded his team about last year when they went to Waco. They were up 38-13 when Baylor came back and made it a close game. So he wants every ounce out of his guys tonight. No cashing it in.
That's right. Last year it finished 38-36. They had a chance for a two-point conversion. Greer, low throw to Sills, incomplete.
You know, it's very interesting, the report from Jen about Brewer, because he was taken out of the game immediately after throwing that final interception. And they must have wanted to take a look at him, saying, this guy's not himself right now. And they went with McClendon. And I believe McClendon's going to take it the rest of the way, especially since Jen's report.
Evan Staley on for his fifth field goal attempt. He's made two, he's missed two.
He had four attempts in the first quarter, I think.
And this time from 44. You can see it flutter, but it's still good from 44. So he's three for his last three. Points off turnovers here for West Virginia now, 44-0. Back here in Morgantown, West Virginia, the Mountaineers ranked 13th in the country after their loss against Iowa State on the road. They're putting it to the Baylor Bears.
Speaking with this coaching staff, this is what they wanted to see. They wanted to come out firing on all cylinders, offensively, defensively. They're playing extremely well. And Coach, he was excited to have this game here tonight.
Casey Legg kicking off. Coming up to make the play is Josh Fleeks. Fleeks, a good return on the short kick. It is Casey Legg, the kicker, who makes the tackle. But Fleeks with a nice return for Baylor.
They've had.
And we heard a report from Jen Hale about the starting quarterback, Charlie Brewer, how he is out for the rest of the game. Jen, you have more on Charlie. What can you tell us?
Yeah, Justin, it wasn't something that Charlie was complaining about, but the coaches say it's not like him to make bad decisions, all those interceptions. So they took a closer look at him, didn't feel like he looked right, and made the decision he needed to go back in and be evaluated.
Well, Jalen McClendon is in. McClendon moving around in the pocket. McClendon runs into his own lineman. And able to take it across the 50 up to the 47-yard line of West Virginia.
He's a big guy now, 6'5", 220 pounds, and just kind of leads into the middle there and gets a really good first down, one of the best first down gains the Bears have had all night.
How about this? This is the first time all game Baylor has been in West Virginia territory.
Credit to Coach Gibson, this defensive coordinator. They're drawing up a lot of pressure, confusing this offensive line, moving from three guys down to four guys down, playing some cover two, cover one on the outside as well.
The handoff to Jamichael Hasty. Hasty will get a yard. Giovanni Stewart, they are the tackle.
He's a young man out of Katy, Texas. Relishes playing in the Big 12, I'm sure. Came into the game with a sack and 24 tackles. There's Coach Gibson. I don't think he could be any more pleased with what his defense has put out here on the field tonight at home.
A watch for McClendon maybe to keep it here on third and one. The big quarterback.
You got big Jalen Hurd, the former running back at Tennessee. Hand it to him. Let him get going at some point.
The quarterback keeps it. And the quarterback is going to get the first down.
It's been such an awkward game for the Bears. I mean, that goes without saying. You look at the score, but Jalen Hurd, who we came in talking about, has barely been out there making plays. Denzel Mims, one of the best-looking receivers in the Big 12, has not been making plays. Chris Platt had a big drop right before the end of the half. They just really have struggled.
Hurd is in there at tailback. McClendon on the slant. It is incomplete for Tyquan Thornton, and a late flag comes in. The coverage by Hakeem Bailey. And we'll see if the referee, Eddie Shelton's microphone was fixed during the half, or my lip reading skills will come back into play. I'm hoping the microphone was fixed.
I think it is fixed.
I don't know. You've been getting pretty good.
They made some great second half adjustments. These refs aren't, you know, they're doing a great job tonight.
Pass interference.
Yeah.
And defense. It works.
Number 24. Spot foul. Automatic first down.
It's like when you haven't been home in a while, you turn on the lights and they still work. There you see the PI. That is Hakeem Bailey there. Not allowing Thornton underneath him get the arm out.
That was a little defense like Gary Payton there. It was a little too aggressive holding. They used to call him the glove.
The glove. The handoff to Hasty. Hasty making a couple of guys miss. Up to the 31, gets five.
See if they can capitalize. They've made some good plays. They got the penalty to get the first down, but when they've moved the ball and they've done some sort of good things, they usually take a step or two back with a penalty, a drop. Let's see if they can capitalize and potentially get points on this drive.
On second and five. A drop ball on the sideline by Chris Platt.
Now, the fastest guy on the field doesn't usually have the best hands, but he's still got to catch that ball and help out his quarterback. You know, there's a lot still here for the Baylor team. We talked about they're not far from bowl eligibility, just two wins.
Right.
Much improved from last year. How they play in this second half and rally together, regardless of the outcome of this game, I think will say a lot about Coach Rhule and the way these guys approach football. They play hard.
Third down and five. Their defense played really hard early on, and just it all caught up to them. In motion is Hurd. McClendon over the middle, completes the pass to Jalen Hurd. And Hurd has the first down in the red zone to the 17-yard line.
This is a guy that they want to get the ball going at any cost. You know, he was a running back, now he's at receiver, but the transition has been fairly smooth for him, dropping some weight, but he's a guy that can go the distance at any time if he has the ball in his hands.
First and 10 from the 17. McClendon rolling out to his right. Now he's got tuck and run. And falls forward up to the 9-yard line. He gets 8.
Talk about Jalen a little bit. I'm impressed. I was able to meet this kid about 2 years ago when he was at the University of Tennessee. 2016 Outback MVP. He was running the ball extremely well for the Vols, and then he made the transfer, made the switch. But he's a guy that's a dynamic player. They're not giving him those opportunities because of the way the game is going. But look for him to get going here shortly.
See if Jalen McClendon can get Jalen Hurd the ball.
On second and 2. The handoff to Hasty, bounces off a tackle, and Hasty is down at the 2-yard line. He gets 7, setting up first and goal.
Now, this has clearly been the best drive for the Baylor Bears so far, and it really hasn't been that complicated. One big throw to Jalen Hurd, some tough runs by Jermichael Hasty, and all it took was a couple quarterback scrambles from McClendon to get him down here in a good position to score. First and goal right on the 2.
And now, maybe, do they line up with Jalen Hurd in the backfield? They do on first and goal from the 2.
Even though he lost a lot of weight to become a receiver, he's still their short yardage running back. I like that.
Yeah, he's a strong, powerful runner.
Instead, they give the ball to Fleeks, and Fleeks gets into the end zone for the touchdown. Josh Fleeks, who had the good return on the kickoff, is able to punch it in from 2 yards out.
The Bears taking a page out of West Virginia's book with the jet sweep.
Yeah, Josh Fleeks, the true freshman. He's a guy that runs extremely hard and fast, but just another wrinkle. You usually give the ball to Hurd down there. Hey, let's get the jet sweep going. Let's get him outside and try to create some separation and mismatches outside the tackles.
Matt Rhule and Jeff Nixon, they're finally able to call some plays and set up their offense a little bit. That's the first time all game.
Connor Martin, the extra point is good. A scoring drive for the Baylor Bears. They get on the scoreboard. 44-7, West Virginia leading here in the third. Uncle of Dustin Pedroia is actually Phil Snow, the defensive coordinator for the Baylor Bears.
I thought it was Waldo.
Of Baylor, they've gotten a commitment from Kyle Nevin, the son of Yankees third base coach Phil Nevin, to play baseball there. Here the kickoff is taken at the 10 by Tevin Bush. Bush waiting for some blockers, and Bush nearly slipped through as he just got tripped up, and he'll be marked down at the 28-yard line. So we talked about the importance of this game for West Virginia, and this is the reason why. You win this game, you move to 6-1, 4-1 in Big 12 play, but then it's the gauntlet. It's Texas, who's ranked number 6 right now in the country, home against TCU, at Oklahoma State, and you finish things up on the road against Oklahoma.
That's a tough road ahead, but I think it's going to come down to that Oklahoma game. I know Texas is playing extremely well, but West Virginia controls their own destiny right now if they can continue to play like they are tonight. But I think it will come down to that Oklahoma game.
And that is going to be a wild atmosphere here in Milan Pushkar Stadium when the Sooners pay a visit. It should be a big Big 12 championship-style game.
It's a little different from the Big 12 when I was here back in 2010 was my last year. They weren't a part of this conference making it in 2012, but I think they bring a great, great sense of urgency, great team. This team is amazing for this conference.
First down here by McCoy. I want you to keep on talking.
I mean, I've never played them, but we did lose to them in the Fiesta Bowl. I was able to see the trophy. I told them, hey, if that trophy comes up missing, it wasn't me.
Now, the official's talking to everybody here. I think it's about being chippy down the stretch and kind of finishing this football game the right way. Guys are kind of getting after it. It's been a little
That was Jim Adams, the umpire, who brought everyone together. I don't know if I've ever seen it like that. I've seen it on the basketball court, but not on the football field.
Trying to restore a little order.
Come to the principal's office. I've never seen that right there.
Or they're saying, do you know where that Fiesta Bowl trophy is? It's McCoy again on the carry. He gets three. For Kedrick Vaughns with his second tackle, it was Vaughns who was able to chase down Tevin Bush after a 78-yard run. Otherwise, it would have been a touchdown. Second down and seven here for the Mountaineers. The pass is caught by the tight end, Trevon Wesco. And Wesco shows off some skills, some athleticism.
Yeah, that's his little celebration is the right bicep flex. Trevon Wesco is a local kid from Martinsburg, West Virginia, closer to the Washington, D.C. area. But it's so important for Dana Holgorsen to get those guys here and find ways to use them because it really energizes the state, believe it or not, the fan base.
Greer, flags are thrown. He just throws it away.
There is no foul for intentional grounding. Quarterback was out of the pocket. The ball reached the line of scrimmage.
You know, working off what DeMarco
was saying.
There
is going to be a flag for something else.
Is there?
Personal foul. Hands to the face.
All right.
Offense, number 79. 15-yard penalty. Replay first down.
Eddie Shelton takes a knock and keeps on ticking.
Very interesting what DeMarco was saying about the Big 12 and how good it is with West Virginia in it and how it's kind of expanded with West Virginia in it. The Big 12 has been absolutely fabulous for West Virginia. It has put them on a national map. The games are much more competitive. People really, really happy about that move with this team.
Delayed handoff to Kennedy McCoy.
You get new facilities when you join a conference like that. It's been about 7 years. They're still doing construction. This campus and this entire program, and not just this program, all the athletic programs have really blossomed in this conference. And a lot of people kind of shrugged their shoulders when West Virginia joined the Big 12. And they said, you know, what about the map? How are people from Oklahoma going to get all the way to Appalachia? But it really has worked out. And we're talking about that Oklahoma game here at the end of the year. That's going to be something else.
Going out in motion now is McCoy. Greer backpedaling, setting up the screen for Sinkfield. Sinkfield. All the way down inside the 20. Picks up 31 yards, chased down by Henry Black. That was a pretty play.
Good call, just a screen, and they hit him exactly where they wanted to. When you run a screen against a blitz, it has the ability to go the distance, and they hit it right on the blitz there. Sinkfield did a great job hiding behind those big offensive line, giving him an outlet to throw the ball. Once he got it, goes upfield, but just another great wrinkle there by this offense.
First and 10 from the 19 here for West Virginia. Sinkfield now on the carry. You know, we were talking with Jake Spavital, and he said to us, he said, we need to be more consistent in the run game, but we also have to take screens and do something with them, and they did it on that previous play.
Yeah, a screen is just, it's awesome. Obviously, as a running back, you love them because you get a chance to get outside the box. You know, you usually don't have these type of receptions, but as a running back, I love them because I can, you know, kind of catch them off guard a little bit. Run against the DBs, the safeties, and not get hit by these big defensive line and linebackers. But the running backs, they've been playing well tonight, and this was a key thing for this offense. We have to get our runners going. We have to get our offensive line being more physical. The guys inside, we talk about the center, the right guard, the left guard.
A 10-yard run for Letty Brown sets up first and goal from the 5 here for the Mountaineers.
They'll get really chippy out there. Well, one of the things about getting your backs going is playing guys more consistently and getting them a rhythm.
Well, they have a couple good backs, and they've all been a running back by committee.
Unsportsmanlike conduct, number 38, Baylor, using profanity. At the distance to the goal, automatic first down. That's his first unsportsmanlike conduct foul.
God forbid.
Against Jordan Williams.
How can you understand with the mouthpiece in?
So now it's first and goal from the three. Letty Brown is in at tailback. They give it to Brown. Brown reaches for the end zone. Touchdown. Fourth touchdown of the year for the true freshman out of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
They like Brown. They feel he's a home run threat, but he's a big, big runner that can break those long runs if he gets going. But he's a physical runner. They're physical runner of this group right there. That's his fifth touchdown, I believe, of the season.
And they're going to take a look at it.
Elbow could have been down there.
I think the elbow was down. Might have been a little too close, but we're going to get a look at it anyway. Letty Brown, young guy out of Philadelphia.
Eddie Shelton will go put the headset on, speak with Gary Brown, the replay official.
You're talking about these running backs and just how many different guys they have. We talked to Dana Holgorsen and Jake Spavital about it. Alex Sinkfield came out of the spring as the number one guy, and now he's kind of their number four guy, and he's still getting a lot of carries. So just goes to show you the depth of this West Virginia offense.
Let's bring in Dean Blandino from Los Angeles and get his thoughts on whether or not this call will stand or be overturned. Dean?
Yeah, just the fact that they stopped it with the score the way that it is tells me that they're going to change it. Looked like the left elbow was down. The ball was just short of the goal line, so they'll probably move the ball back maybe about 6 inches from the goal line here.
Look at Dean just going with the common sense right there, saying that they stopped it with this score. And here we have the call.
After further review, the runner was short of the goal line. It'll be second down.
Score a point for common sense.
I thought that was lost in this day and age.
Well, it will be if they come out in a shotgun here. We'll see if they get Will Greer under center.
So take the touchdown off the board for Letty Brown. He is in there, though. And Greer is under center. They give it back to Brown. And this time, Letty is in. Let him in. Ten plays, 72 yards for West Virginia on that scoring drive.
I'm coming off that performance they had at Ames. You can't imagine things going better for the Mountaineers going into the gauntlet at the end of the Big 12 season for them. Just a great showing here on a Thursday night in front of everybody. Just exactly what this team can do it. I believe this quarterback is still every bit of a Heisman Trophy candidate after this performance.
Evan Staley's extra point is good. Well, they'll be singing this real loud at the end of this game. West Virginia leading 51-7 with 5:34 to go here in the third quarter. Letty Brown gets his fourth rushing touchdown of the year. They took it away, and then he did it again. You want to get a workout in? You got to do all those push-ups.
Noodle arms tomorrow with 51 points.
And then go walk Pikewood National Golf Club and you'll be all set. You won't be able to feel your legs or your arms.
That's a tough state. It's even the golf clubs.
And this will go into the end zone for a touchback. So Baylor, behind Jalen McClendon, will take over at the 25 again, trailing 51-7. And again, Petros, you were talking about this on the previous drive, but it says a lot about Matt Rhule and this Baylor team. How do they come out and play here in this third and fourth quarter, having such a, let's be honest, abysmal first half?
Yeah, an abysmal game, really. And what you do when you face adversity in this sport is really what defines you. The adversity doesn't define you. It's how you respond to it.
The pass is complete to Tyquan Thornton. And let's get more on that from Shen Hill.
Yeah, Justin, I think Petros is a little clairvoyant, or he was listening in to Matt Rhule's speech to his team, because that's exactly what he told them. What defines you not just as a football player, but also as a man, is how you respond when things are going poorly. And things couldn't really go any worse than they did in that first half. So he's keeping tabs and watching on how these guys respond tonight in the second half.
There's a reason why Matt Rhule can turn around programs. Hasty gets caught in the backfield by Josh Norwood. Trying to change directions. It's going to be a loss of four on the play by number four.
Just to elaborate a little bit on what Petro said, they have Oklahoma State, another opponent in the Big 12 Conference, but they're watching this film. You can't lay another egg the second half, but it's all about finishing, and we know the score, but you have to finish, and that's the biggest thing that coaches want to see.
Josh Norwood finished that play. He's been very active in this game.
You see six tackles for a loss by the defense for West Virginia. They average almost nine per game. This pass is caught by Jalen Hurd. And with that, it's a first down.
Coach Gibson, he's still dialing up these blitzes, but here you see Hasty steps up there. And McClendon just throws the ball to Jalen Hurd on an out route, but this is what they needed in the first half to keep these drives alive. They've been very, very limited on third downs.
Just two catches, 23 yards for Jalen Hurd. McClendon, pressure coming off the edge, across the middle, and that pass is caught by Chris Platt. So it's now 18 straight games of the reception for Platt.
And that's one of those things, overcoming adversity. You've seen Platt have a couple drops. Here he has a positive play. Might not mean that much for this game, but it means a lot for the future.
Well, he's a senior guy, so he knows he made those mistakes, but just the fact that he's still in the game and he's still trying, that's what you want to see. I'm going to go down swinging at all costs.
McClendon keeps it. And McClendon loses the ball as he goes to the ground, tackle by David Long. But a 7-yard run for Jalen McClendon. A good job again on that zone read, keeping it.
And he's done a good job of coming in and just kind of stabilizing things for this Baylor offense. The chaos that was the Baylor offense kind of ended when Jalen McClendon came into the game.
Yeah, and second-string quarterbacks, they usually don't get that many reps during the week. So the fact that he's in here, he's protecting the ball, and he's making some good throws. He's had a couple drops from his receivers, but the fact that Jalen is coming to the game, he's kind of gave them a little momentum at certain times.
McClendon keeps it, rolls out to his right, throws towards the sideline, and that one is caught. Nice catch by Tyquan Thornton. And that goes for 18 yards.
Thornton's their guy that goes over the top. Not a big guy at all, just a freshman, 165 pounds. And you have to respect his ability to take the top off the defense. Bailey lets him make that cut. A well-delivered ball on the run by Jalen McClendon, and Baylor's on the move again.
And a nice job getting the arms underneath that ball by the freshman Thornton. First and 10 from the 23-yard line. And it's the handoff to Fleeks, but Fleeks has nowhere to go, and he just gets thrown to the ground.
Matthew Henry, he's a guy that has played 45 games. That's every game in his career. He's leads his team with two interceptions. He's one of my favorite players on this team. He flies around. He makes plays in the passing game. He's not afraid to tackle as well, but I love the way he plays, and the best ability is availability. I'm sure the scouts, they're going to look at that. 45 games, 45 plays. That's great for that young guy.
All starts for Drayvon Askew Henry in his career. Second down and 16. Pressure coming. McClendon able to find Thornton again. And there may have been the first missed tackle of the game. Shea Campbell missed a tackle. This one goes for 11.
And that was something they really wanted to concentrate on after Montgomery ran right through him like butter. The West Virginia defense had a really tough time. There's Kenny Bigelow. Montgomery from Iowa State ran right through these guys. They missed 32 tackles last week, and that was a real point of emphasis for Coach Gibson going into this game.
Jones goes in motion here on third and five. McClendon
completes the pass. And that's to Denzel Mims, who gets tackled at the one. A 17-yard completion, and now Mims extends his consecutive game streak to 19 with a catch.
He's their third down guy. Coming in, he leads the team with touchdowns with four of those, but he's a guy that they needed in the first half that they're just starting to get going a little bit.
No sign yet from the officials. And there it is, touchdown. The touchdown by Jalen McClendon. And that's an impressive drive by the Baylor Bears.
It's all fight and all heart by this offense. Not giving up, knowing what the score is, but hey, we're going to continue to play no matter what the situation is. We're going to fight and scratch and claw till it's double zero at the end of the clock.
Looked like encroachment there by the West Virginia defense, but no flag, no foul. Touchdown Bears. And Coach Rule's speech seems to be having a little bit of an effect on his team. There he is talking to Hurd.
And they love Hurd, the way he plays, the way he practices. They say he loves football.
Well, a couple of good drives on this quarter for Baylor as they now trail 51-14. And he capped it off with a one-yard touchdown run.
20 games he's played, but that was a good drive right there, leading that offense down a good seven. He's a dual threat guy that can run, as we saw in that last drive, and he opened it up a little bit with his legs.
Drew Galitz to kick off here for the Bears, and they're going to try to go onside kick. Ball is loose, still loose. The flag is thrown. Not sure it traveled the needed distance.
Who crossed the line?
Still no signal yet on who's recovered it.
Good onside kick, really.
Perfect onside kick. That's what you want. Pop it up high in the air. Let your guys have a play at the ball in the sky.
You can see the wrestling still going on. But West Virginia has it. But again, there are a couple of flags on the play. Logan Timmons, a fullback, is the one who recovered.
Very well executed onside kick. It's got to go 10.
It went the 10 yards.
Goes the 10.
There are two fouls by the kicking team. Offside, number 84. That foul's declined. Kick catch interference, number 84. That foul's accepted. 15 yards from the end of the kick. First down, Baylor.
So two fouls on Haskins. Do you have to give him a halo there on an onside?
Yeah, I didn't understand that one. I didn't understand that.
When it's up in the air like that, you do, unless it's on the ground. If it's on the ground, you can hit that guy unless it's targeting.
Well, he kicked it. It hits the ground when he didn't pooch it up.
Right.
Did he pooch it up? Yeah, he did pooch it up. Right. That was...
Let's bring in Dean Blandino to get some clarification on what just transpired. Dean?
Yeah, so this was a change a couple of years ago. The old rule was the ball had to be kicked directly into the air to get protection. Now if it's kicked once into the ground and you get that high hop, the receiving team still gets the opportunity, an unimpeded opportunity to make the catch.
Thanks, Dean.
And why run the play? Gotta give the guy room.
Well, here's a screen to Sills. And Sills is gonna lose a couple of yards as Jack Allison is in at quarterback.
And I like seeing the quarterback change. I don't know why David Sills is still in the game. Jack Allison, a sophomore, he's the guy of the future, and he's huge. 6'6", 200 pounds out of Miami.
You know what's huge? The lead for the Mountaineers through three.
fourth quarter. Here in Morgantown, it has really been all West Virginia. Baylor, if you want a moral victory, they outscored the Mountaineers in the third quarter, 14-10. Allison is in his first pass attempt to the end zone. Oh, Gary, the touchdown for Gary Jennings. Second of the game for Jennings, and Allison is loving it.
Coach Holgorsen wants to show the fans what the quarterback of the future can do. 6 foot six, delivers a beautiful ball to Jennings. There's a route.
Jennings just ran a seam route and covered two safeties, staying outside the hash, and he just bends it right in the middle, and Allison finds it, but there was no one to contest that throw. That's the second time that's happened for Jennings. He's had two easy touchdowns.
Three catches, 100 yards, two touchdowns for Jennings. Snap, not a good one. A good adjustment by the holder, Billy Kinney. And Staley, a little stutter step. He puts the extra point in. But Jack Allison with his first touchdown pass of the season. It is all Mountaineers here in Morgantown. 14:53 to go here in the fourth quarter. 58-14, they lead. Will Greer, he's got the ski hat on. Yep, it is that cold. His night is done.
Rightfully so. He's had an unbelievable night. I mean, he's one of the top quarterbacks. We had a chance to see Justin Herbert from Oregon, and Greer is a fantastic quarterback with a fast release, and he puts the ball exactly where he wants to be.
Luke Hogan. Kickoff. Fleeks from the nine. Fleeks. Penalty flag is thrown. And let's see where they mark him down at the 22-yard line, but let's find out what this flag is for. Another flag is thrown.
Trying hard to restore order. These officials in a game that's been out of reach for quite some time for the Bears.
Earning that paycheck tonight, they got to keep order. There's a lot of feisty guys on both sides, but you got to keep your composure.
There are two fouls by the kicking team, receiving team, correction. There is a foul by each team, holding, receiving team. 10 yards from the spot of the foul. After the play, unsportsmanlike, number 25, kicking team. That's number 25's first unsportsmanlike conduct. It'll be 15 yards from the succeeding spot. First down, Baylor.
Well, we'll put those penalties away and let's talk about the quarterbacks, because DeMarco, you had mentioned a couple. Justin Herbert, Will Greer, that we've seen so far this year.
I know I'm getting a lot of backlash because Tua's not here, but I need to see him play in the fourth quarter. But I like Kyler Murray. I love Kyler Murray right there at number three. But these are great quarterbacks that hopefully are Heisman hopefuls, and they lead their offense. Just Will Greer, he has full command and control of this offense. Not a lot of college quarterbacks can call plays and dial them up whenever they want, but they give him full authority to do that.
The pass is caught over the middle by Jalen Hurd.
One of the things they really like about Jalen Hurd is how hard he plays. A running back position, you get the ball, you got to run hard into the line of scrimmage. As a wide receiver, he approaches running his routes in the same kind of way. He really attacks the defensive backs. We haven't gotten to see his best tonight, but a great transition from the running back to the receiver position.
McClendon, good job moving around in the pocket. On the run, throws and completes the pass to Chris Platt, and Platt is tackled down at the 35-yard line. He gets 24. Well, if you want good news for Baylor, what you have is a very capable backup in Jalen McClendon.
Well, earlier in the season, I mean, they were trading snaps. It was not a clear cut. Charlie Brewer is our starter until pretty recently, and McClendon has handled it pretty well and obviously ready to go when called upon.
Now he's going to dump it off to Lovett. Lovett with some room, lowers that shoulder as he saw a bunch of blue jerseys. And he'll get 18 yards there to move the chains again. As he's down to the 17-yard line. Red zone opportunity for Baylor. McClendon is 10 for his last 10. Makes a move. Stiff arm. Oh, and he just got leveled. Dante Stills came up and delivered the blow when McClendon was looking at the other guy giving a stiff arm.
Ouch, ouch. The true freshman. Listen to this. He just comes up and delivers a huge blow. Not the shot you want from your quarterback. The true freshman, 6'4", 294 pounds. He is big, strong, and as you can see on that last play, extremely physical.
Still be a very physical game without using your helmet.
Fumble! And McClendon able to dive on it.
Stunned by X-ray Lowe. Finds himself in the backfield there, creating chaos. Right away, Lowe is there to disrupt that mesh. And a third long for McClendon.
Honestly, I can't believe McClendon didn't have the wind knocked out of him on that hit by Dante Stills.
Tough player. I mean, to take that hit.
I got the wind knocked out of me.
To take that hit and get back up and continue to this drive, I mean, I'm sure he already has respect from his teammates, but after that, they'll have even more respect for him.
A timeout is called here by West Virginia with third and 14 coming up.
First timeout of the half. Media timeout.
58-14. West Virginia leading here in the fourth. For Baylor, Treston Ebner is in at tailback. Jalen McClendon in the shotgun. Pressure coming. McClendon gets rid of it to the end zone. Jump ball. No flag. And the defense by Josh Norwood against Denzel Mims.
Norwood's been very good all game, and this is really what the Baylor receivers do well in one-on-one situations. Get up and make plays. Denzel Mims is 6'3", 210 pounds. Norwood makes a little contact, maybe gets away with a push with the right hand there. And McClendon takes a big hit again to the midsection.
And of course, trailing 58-14, Baylor's going for it. They enter the backfield.
Here comes that blitz once again.
McClendon cannot escape the blitz. It's X-ray low. He forced the fumble earlier. Now he gets the sack for the turnover on downs.
Gibson, he's just drawing up all types of pressures, not knowing where they're coming from, doing a great job of disguising him in low. There's no one coming. He's only five protectors. There's only five. He's bringing eight guys there. I mean, you have to get rid of the ball, but, I mean, just another blitz there by this defense. They're getting after the quarterback on all cylinders.
They're showing a lot of things to their future opponents at the Big 12 to be accountable to. You have to worry about this defense and how fast they are, how quickly they can rally to the football. And we've seen the offensive weapons on display all night here at Morgantown.
They're playing a complete game. Obviously, they've had a couple missed kicks early from the field goal, but offensively and defensively, this is what this coaching staff preached to us, and this is what they want to see moving forward.
The handoff is to Alex Sinkfield. And Sinkfield up to the 31, tackled by Bravion Roy. 5-yard run for Sinkfield. Will Greer, 17 of 27, 353, three touchdowns. Jack Allison just had his first touchdown pass of his career when he was able to find Gary Jennings for his second touchdown of the night, which brings Jennings' touchdown total on the season to 8, trailing his teammate David Sills, who's gotten 2 and now has 9 on the season. Sinkfield again on the handoff. We'll get a yard.
We talked about the weapons that the Mountaineers have on offense. I mean, we've seen Gary Jennings, who's really impressive with two touchdown catches on the night. David Sills, a fabulous wide receiver. Tevin Bush, really fast guy that runs a jet sweep. They've got two different tight ends involved. All the running backs we've been talking about. This is a formidable offense.
They have a lot of weapons, a lot of athletes who can go the distance at call, you know, so with Greer leading this offense, no telling what they can do, and the sky's the limit for this offense.
Allison gets rid of it to one of those tight ends, Durante Haskins. Haskins will come up shy of the first down marker.
And using tight ends and fullbacks was not really something that was in Dana Holgorsen's wheelhouse when he first came here to West Virginia. It's kind of something that developed. When he was at Oklahoma State, they used the running game and fullbacks and things of that nature. But it's really something that's developed for Coach Holgorsen in the Big 12 as he's developed as a head man in the Big 12. He's done a great job here.
He's done an extremely nice job with this program. 20 players drafted since being named head coach. That's second in the Big 12. I mean, they find players no matter where they're from. You know they want to get the guys from West Virginia for the home team, but he recruits all over the place, and he's finding great athletes that fits the mold that he wants for his team.
Delay a game. 15 of the offense. 5-yard penalty. Remains fourth down.
This is the first punt of the night for Billy Kinney.
Wow.
14 possessions for West Virginia. First punt.
Well, that's what DeMarco means when he says you played a complete game. That's pretty complete. You have to wait till your backup quarterback and almost backup everybody's in the game before you punt it away.
And he gets off a good punt. Fair catch by Pooh Strickland at the 20. A 50-yard punt. Everybody in Morgantown, they're happy. Even Waldo's getting into it.
There he is. I found him.
I remember the 90s.
You can't be the Mountaineer unless you have a good beard. None of us would qualify to be the Mountaineer.
I used to grow my beard out. I don't know if Fox will allow me to grow that thing out now that I'm on television.
Are you telling me that you could compete with Trevor?
I can't compete with that, but okay. I can't.
Come on, a beard like that would give you Fox attitude.
McClendon trying to break free, trying to dump it off. That ball's still live. Picking it up is Ebner. And now Ebner gets taken down inside the five at the three. It was a lateral by McClendon. He threw it behind him. And all of a sudden, Ebner realized, uh-oh, there's no whistle. I got to pick this ball up.
That's about as ugly of a football play as you're going to see. McClendon just making a poor decision. You just need to take this sack or find a way to get rid of the football, but not backwards to your back there.
Dante Stills applying the pressure. Dante Stills was the one who leveled him earlier.
And it's an awkward thing for Ebner, but he should have never shown McClendon his hands, like, give me the football. It's just a bad move.
A loss of 17 on the play. The pass complete to Mims. Mims gets tackled at the 14-yard line. They'll mark him down at the 15. They get 12 yards back. Third down and long coming up.
It's their third game, top 25 of road opponent. I mean, last week or 2 weeks ago against Texas, they were one possession away. You know, they could have scored and won that ball game, but this is a totally different team, and it's been ugly from the start.
Third-ranked opponent in their last four games. Dump it off to Ebner. And Ebner, that's a good tackle by Hakeem Bailey.
And that's a pretty good example of what West Virginia is this year defensively, whether they're backups in the game or the starters. What they do really well is rally to the football with speed. And that really bodes well for the conference and who they have left on the schedule. They are a fast football team, and it's going to be hard to get over the top of this defense.
Yeah, their defensive line has been a strength of this team, but this is the number one scoring defense in the Big 12, which is hard to do with all these explosive offenses, and you play guys every week that they score a lot of points, but they've been solid throughout the course of the year.
Fair catch is made at the 40-yard line after a 38-yard punt. 6:50 to go here in the fourth quarter in Morgantown. Forward to that. Thank you very much. Of course, Kyler Murray, top 10 pick in baseball. Here on first down, the handoff to Sinkfield. Sinkfield gets tackled for a loss by Clay Johnston.
Coach Wonstadt's going to tell us about Texas. What about Baylor? Can't they tell us about Texas? They were this far from beating them.
Well, Texas, a couple weeks ago, had the injury to Ellinger. And so what's going to be the status of him going forward and how that plays into it?
And he's their alpha. Ellinger is their quarterback. I like Shane Buechele. I think he's a great young man, and he's done some really good things for that Texas program. But Ellinger has the toughness, as you saw in the Red River rivalry. Sorry, DeMarco.
I saw it firsthand. Don't remind me. But, no, he's a respected quarterback, and he plays extremely well. I love to watch him play that game.
That was a quick release by Allison, complete to Haskins, the tight end. Gets 7 yards. I like that quick release by this big quarterback.
That's why they have him here. Dana Holgorsen knows how to go down and get him. And this is a much different model than old Skyler Howard, that tough quarterback out of Fort Worth, Texas, who was more of a runner and kind of a scrapper. These big guys like Will Greer, Jack Allison, Geno Smith. That's when Dana Holgorsen really becomes that downfield throwing offensive genius that got the job in the first place.
Third down and 5. Allison. He takes a big hit, fumbles, and able to recover. The hit was by Christian Morgan. A vicious blow by Christian Morgan against the backup quarterback, Allison.
And they really put Allison at risk in this situation, pulling the ball, and then he kind of hesitates, and Morgan really makes him pay. And that bodes well for Baylor. They're still playing hard out there trying to make plays and put some stuff on tape to feel positive going forward.
Just talking about Holgorsen a little bit, former offensive coordinator. I played against him when he was at Oklahoma State, but just the respect that he has for Coach Spav to let him, hey, this is your team, this is your offense. I'm going to let you control it and not call the play. So that's a huge, huge credit for Spav.
It's been slow letting go for Dana Holgorsen, but it's happened, and they're better for it.
I bet.
Well, how about the night for Will Greer? We came in talking about him. He didn't disappoint.
Not at all. Just a quick release. He puts the ball where it needs to be. He's one of the toughest quarterbacks. And like we mentioned earlier, they give him full control. A lot of these plays where he's changing protection, he's giving his receiver signals, hey, give me this, give me that. But he knows and understands this offense. He's a very smart guy, cerebral guy. They put a lot on his plate, but he's a competitor. And I love that about him. He's an amazing quarterback, one of the top quarterbacks in the nation for sure. He'll be playing on Sundays.
Yeah, he really does seem to be in full control. And another thing that really impressed me about Dana Holgorsen's offense tonight was just how creative David Sills at the wide receiver position is, finding ways to get off the ball, different releases, and his communication with his quarterback is second to none.
Ebner gets tackled in the backfield. A loss of 2 on the play. The producer of tonight's game is Kevin Patterson, the director, Renardo Lowe. Our technical producer is Mark Alsmeyer. Associate director is Caden Pfeiffer. Broadcast associates, Dan Radoff, Matt Gossip. Statistician up here in the booth is Mitch Smith. And our spotter is Ken Trevor. Under 4 to go here in this fourth quarter. On a night that has been all West Virginia, Ebner gets shoved out of bounds by Jordan Adams.
Ebner, just a sophomore, Henderson, Texas. Came into the game with 33 carries. Nice run, nice finish. I have been impressed with the way Baylor's responded here in the second half. They really could have wilted and made this thing a lot worse.
McClendon over the middle. It's dropped by Josh Fleeks. That was the announcer jinx by Petros Papadakis.
kind of been the story. They've had a couple drops, and you know, this offense just never got comfortable from start to finish with Brewer throwing those interceptions early on. Never quite looked right, and they took him out because of the head. But this offense, they, you know, the bye week is always hard to come back after a bye week. They've had a long couple of days, and losing to Texas, having that bye week, and you tend to lose the fundamental side of the game at times.
Fundamentals, that's one of the things that Matt Rhule really focuses on. Ebner trying to find some place to go, could not. Under 3.5 to go here.
Speaking of fundamentals, that was really one of the things Dana Holgorsen, who is, you know, an offensive genius, throw the ball downfield, all that stuff, but that wasn't his message after losing the game at Iowa State. His message was blocking and tackling, and that's how simple this game is. And you can see he's still coaching about as hard as possible because he knows what's to come in the Big 12.
You gotta love him, just his personality. That was my first time meeting him in person, but I love his personality. He's well respected around this league, but he's such an honest guy. He's very blunt with his team. He knows what they can be if they just continue to play the way they play tonight.
Ebner gets tackled at the 35. He needs two more yards for that first down marker. You know, it wasn't just Dana Holgorsen who knew what was at stake. We talked how we got a chance to speak with Gary Jennings. And I thought Jennings, we were all just so impressed with how intelligent he is as a young man, but he talked about the importance of this game and getting things back and what they did about those fundamentals, their route running, about where they're making their steps, their outs, all that stuff, but also about what they have coming up. It's this game, and then they know how hard their November is going to be.
And he echoed every coach that we spoke to. Hey, we know what we did last week. It was wrong. That wasn't the West Virginia team that we're accustomed to being, but we had a great week of practice. We had a players-only meeting, offensively and defensively, and we said, hey, guys, we know what's at stake. We know the games we have coming up. This is a great jump start. If we can play the way that we've been playing the first five games and lead us the way we want to be led. And Jennings, he's an impressive young man, I will say.
And full disclosure, we spoke with Jennings first. So that was before the coaches came in to talk to us. And this is, again, what they have coming up. Next week, they're at Texas. That could be a huge, huge showdown. Back here against TCU on the 10th at Oklahoma State. And they wrap things up against Oklahoma.
Is that how empty the stadium is? Gary can hear us?
For Baylor, still a lot to play for, as Jen had talked about in the open, hoping to go to a bowl game. They need two more wins to become bowl eligible. This is who they have left on the docket. And can they get two wins out of those last four games?
Absolutely they can. I mean, this is a much better football team, and we'll see what the situation is with Charlie Brewer. I didn't mind seeing McClendon out there running around, but I believe Coach Rhule's team is much better than they showed tonight. Coming off the bye week, like DeMarco said, sometimes things just get away from you, and that's certainly what happened here.
It's Lorenzo Dorr on the carry.
And for West Virginia, you know, you talk about Gary Jennings and his resolve about coming back from that game last week, and this team, they really were tired of hearing everybody talk in this town about how poorly they played in Ames, and they've erased that memory tonight.
And I can tell with the veteran group, they have the blinders on. They're not listening to the outside noise outside the locker room. It's all about the guys in this locker room, the coaching staff and the support staff. So I know a lot of older guys, but they say, hey, guys, let's not listen to that. That's all noise. Let's hunker down. We know what's at stake. Let's finish these games and play the way we can play.
Third and nine, trying to run out the clock. And that should do it. West Virginia, they got off to a great start. A touchdown in the opening minute. A couple of missed field goals kept Baylor in it early. But then it all came undone for Baylor. Their offense couldn't keep West Virginia's offense off the field. And West Virginia, a 44-point win, the largest win in this series history. We've seen some crazy games between these two, but this one, 58-14. The Mountaineers take down the Baylor Bears to improve to 6-1, 4-1 in Big 12 play. For Petros Papadakis, DeMarco Murray, and Jen Hale, I am Justin Kutcher saying so long from Morgantown. We'll get you to L.A. and the guys in the studio right after this break.